Hello everyone, welcome to the case review session of bone tumors. Let's review this case. This is a case of a 22-year-old male who presented with an increasingly painful proximal right tibial lesion associated with a soft tissue mass. So this is the AP and lateral radiograph of the right knee joint of the patient, and we will evaluate this bone tumor on the basis of following points. First is age of the patient. So as we can see, age of the patient is 22 years. Second is whether the lesion is single or multiple. So as we can see, the lesion is involving proximal tibia and it is single. Next is the skeletal location. So it is involving the appendicular skeleton and it is involving long bone. What is the site of long bone involvement? As we can see, it is involving epiphyseal and metaphyseal lesion of the region of the tibia, but it is also extending into diaphysis. And it is involving medullary cavity. It is predominantly central in location. Next is pattern of growth and bone destruction. So as we can see, it is having permeative pattern of bone destruction with wide zone of transition. Next is type of periosteal reactions. As we can see, the lesion is having aggressive pattern of periosteal reaction. Next is matrix mineralization. The lesion is having osseous, cloud-like, matrix in the tumor. Next is soft tissue involvement. So as we can see, the lesion is having soft tissue involvement outside the bone. So this is a case of an ill-defined lytic sclerotic lesion centrally located in the proximal tibia with osseous matrix mineralization and soft tissue involvement. So this is a case of osteosarcoma, and specifically a case of conventional osteosarcoma. Osteosarcomas are most common primary malignant bone tumor in young adults and adolescent age group. It commonly affects 10 to 25 years of age range with a 2:1 male predominance. Painful swelling of the lower limb is a common presenting symptom. Metaphysis of the distal femur, proximal tibia and proximal humerus are the most common sites of involvement. 50% of cases are sclerotic, 25% are purely lytic, and 25% are mixed lesions. Osteosarcomas can present with cannonball metastasis in the lung with ossification in the metastatic tissue. And these lesions can cause spontaneous pneumothorax in the chest. Let's review this case. This is the case of a 21-year-old female who presented with swelling in the distal femur for 2 months. This is the AP and lateral knee radiograph of this patient, and we will evaluate the bone tumor on the basis of following headings. First is age of the patient. As we know, age of the patient is 21 years, so she is a young female. However, the physis are close and she is a skeletally mature patient. Next is whether the lesion is single or multiple. So as we can see, the lesion is single and it is involving distal femur. A skeletal location, it is appendicular skeletal in location and it is involving long bone. What is the site of long bone involvement? As we can see, the lesion is involving epiphyseal and metaphyseal region of distal femur. The lesion is eccentric, expansile, and it is reaching up to the subarticular region. Next is pattern of growth and bone destruction. So as we can see, the lesion is having geographic to Morphetan pattern of bone destruction with narrow zone of transition. Next is the type of periosteal reaction. So as we can see, there is mild periosteal buttressing and the periosteal reaction is predominantly non-aggressive type. Pattern of matrix mineralization. So as we can see, there is no obvious chondroid or osseous matrix mineralization in the tumor. Next is the soft tissue involvement. So as we can see, there is slight soft tissue involvement in the popliteal region because of the cortical breach. So this is a case of a well-defined lytic lesion eccentrically located in the distal femoral epiphysis with subchondral and metaphyseal extension and associated focal breach of the cortex. So radiographically, this is giant cell tumor or osteoblastoma, but there are certain differentials which we need to consider. These differentials are chondroblastoma, aneurysmal bone cyst, and round tumor of hyperparathyroidism. So why it is not chondroblastoma? Because chondroblastomas generally affect skeletally immature patients with non-fused epiphyses, and the lesions are predominantly epiphyseal in location. Aneurysmal bone cyst generally have soap bubble matrix, and ABC also affects in the age group. Next is brown tumor of hyperparathyroidism. In this patient, we are not seeing any other radiographic signs of hyperparathyroidism, so this is not a brown tumor. This patient was histopathologically proven GCT, and she was treated with denosumab for 4 months, and this drug led to ossification of the tumor matrix, and this was followed by cementing of the lesion. So giant cell tumor predominantly affects age group of 20 to 40 years. The most common locations are distal femur and distal radius. The lesions are eccentric and expansile. The lesions are predominantly metaphyseal and epiphyseal in location, extending into the subarticular region. The lesions can cause thinning of the cortex. They have predominantly geographic pattern of bone destruction. And internal septations can be seen, which is predominantly because of ABC transformation of the GCT. So this was all about giant cell tumor or osteoclastoma. This is the case of a 3-year-old female who presented with an increasingly painful forearm soft tissue mark lesion and a recent onset of low-grade fever. This is the frontal radiograph of the forearm of the patient. And we will review this swelling on the basis of following criteria. First is age of the patient. So age of the patient is 3 years and she is a young child. Whether the lesion is single or multiple, so as we can see, the lesion is single. And it is involving ulna. Skeletal location is appendicular skeleton and it is involving long bone. Site of long bone involvement, so as we can see, the lesion is involving diaphysis of ulna, and it is involving the medullary cavity, so it is predominantly central with expansion. Pattern of growth and bone destruction, so as we can see, the lesion is having permeative pattern of bone destruction with wide zone of transition. Talking about the types of periosteal reactions, as we can see, it is aggressive in nature. The periosteal reaction is aggressive and it is of onion skin and Cordman Engel type. Pattern of matrix mineralization is difficult to comment upon as there is aggressive onion skin type of periosteal reaction and there is no obvious osseous or chondroid matrix within the tumor. Soft tissue involvement, as we can see, this lesion is having soft tissue involvement within the forearm soft tissue. So this is a case of a large, ill-defined, destructive, diaphyseal, intramedullary lesion with permeative pattern of bone destruction and periosteal reaction of onion skin type. So, this is a case of Ewing sarcoma. Ewing sarcomas are classified as a round cell tumor along with multiple myeloma and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma of bone. Localized pain with swelling at the site of the lesion is a common symptom. It may mimic infection, systemic signs of slight fever, secondary anemia, leukocytosis, and increased ESR are common. It is the only primary malignant bone tumor with symptoms simulating an infection. The long tuberous bones of the lower extremities are most commonly affected. Innominate bone is the most common flat bone affected and it is the most common primary malignant bone tumor to metastasize to bones. This is a case of a 10-year-old male who presented with swelling in the distal forearm for 5 months. This is the radiograph of the distal forearm and wrist of the patient, and this part is under plaster cast. And we will review the swelling again under following subheading. First is age of the patient. So as we know, age of the patient is 10 years. So this is a X-ray of a young child. Second, the lesion is either single or multiple. So as we can see, the lesion is single. It is involving distal end of radius. Next is skeletal location. So as we can see, this is involving appendicular skeleton and it is involving long bone. Next is the site of long bone involvement. As we can see, the lesion is involving epiphyseal and metaphyseal region of the distal radius. And this lesion is expansile in nature. Pattern of growth and bone destruction. So this lesion is having geographic pattern of bone destruction with narrow zone of transition. Types of periosteal reaction. So the periosteal reaction is of non-aggressive type. Pattern of matrix mineralization. So there is no obvious cartilaginous or osseous matrix, but there is typical soap bubble internal appearance. There is no obvious soft tissue involvement. So this is a case of a well-defined expansile lytic lesion located in the distal radial epiphysis and metaphysis with soap bubble appearance. So this is a case of aneurysmal bone cyst. The differential diagnosis will include giant cell tumor, but giant cell tumors are generally seen in middle age group when the epiphysis is closed. Aneurysmal bone cyst involves 75% of the cases present between the ages of 5 and 20 years. In long bones, ABCs generally involve metaphysis and diaphysis, whereas in spine, it involves neural arch and it gives an appearance of inflated spine. The lesions generally have geographic pattern of bone destruction. They are eccentric, expansile. They have very thin peripheral cortex and they have light internal septations. They give an appearance of blown out or finger in the balloon sign. Spinal lesions in the neural arch must be differentiated from osteoblastoma. Osteoblastomas generally have osseous matrix, whereas ABCs have soap bubble appearance. MRI demonstrates a classic fluid level. So this was all about aneurysmal bone cyst. I hope you have enjoyed the video. Thank you. This is a case of a 45-year-old female who presented with swelling in the region of pubic symphysis for 2 months. This is the frontal radiograph of the pelvis of the patient covering both hip joints. And we will review this swelling on the basis of foreign subheadings. First is age of the patient. So as we know, age of the patient is 45 years and she is a middle-aged female. Second is whether the lesion is single or multiple. So as we can see, the lesion is single. Third is the skeletal location. So as we can see, the lesion is involving axial skeleton. It is involving left pubic rami. Site of long bone involvement is not applicable in this case. Pattern of growth and bone destruction. So as we can see, the lesion is having more thetan pattern of bone destruction with wide zone of transition. Periosteal reaction is of aggressive type. Pattern of matrix mineralization. So as we can see, the lesion is having a small focus of calcification with internal septation. And there is definitive soft tissue involvement. So this is a case of an ill-defined expansile lytic lesion located in the left pubic rami with internal calcifications and thin septa. So this is a case of chondrosarcoma. The differential diagnosis will include metastasis, giant cell tumor, plasmacytoma, and round tumor of hyperparathyroidism. Metastasis can be excluded on the basis of absence of other lesions in the skeleton and absence of any known primary. Giant cell tumor can be kept as a differential in this case. Plasmacytoma will also present as a solitary osteolytic lesion. However, it will not have a foci of internal calcification. Round tumor of hyperparathyroidism can also be excluded on the basis of absence of other skeletal features of hyperparathyroidism. This is the CT of the same patient showing expansile lytic lesion involving left pubic rami with thinned out cortex. This is the MRI of the same patient showing the lesion is appearing very hyper intense on the detuvated sequence and it is having extensive post contrast enhancement. So chondrosarcoma represents the third most common primary malignant bone tumor following myeloma and osteosarcoma. It affects 40 to 60 years of age with 2:1 male predominance. It can be primary or de novo, or it can be secondary because of degeneration in the osteochondroma or enchondroma. The closer the lesion to the axial skeleton, the higher the potential for malignant degeneration. Prognosis is good with 90% survival after early surgery. So this was all about chondrosarcoma. I hope you have enjoyed the video. Thank you.